Section 13 of Builders of United Italy by Rupert S. Holland. Chapter 7. Garibaldi, the Crusader. Part 2. 10 years of patient waiting and subtle diplomacy mark the decade between the siege of Rome in 1859. In that time, Cavour, by the successive steps of the Crimean War, the Congress of Paris, and the secret pact of Plombières, has succeeded in isolating Austria from the other powers, and in allying Louis Napoleon with Piedmont. His next step was to prepare actively for war, and with this purpose he called Garibaldi to see him at Turin. Garibaldi went to the minister's house, dressed in his usual campaign clothes, wearing a loose red blouse and broad-brimmed hat, and refused to give his name to the servant. On Cavour's hearing of the presence of such a disreputable-appearing stranger, he said, "Let the poor devil in. He probably has some petition to ask of me." The meeting was most amicable. Cavour asked Garibaldi to command the new volunteer army, known as the Hunters of the Alps, and Garibaldi was delighted to accept. Immediately he began recruiting his forces, and so spontaneous was the rising throughout northern and central Italy that by May of that year he was at the head of 3 regiments of infantry well equipped for instant service. Austria was dismayed and demanded that Cavour dismiss the men, but by what was probably the most fortunate coup in his whole career, Cavour was able to appear willing to have peace and yet force Austria to war. Napoleon stood by Piedmont, and in May 1859 the campaign that was to redeem the inglorious field of Novara commenced. Garibaldi's great reputation caused friction between him and the officers of the regular army, and he who had been used to the greatest freedom of action found himself seriously hampered by directions from headquarters. He hailed with delight King Victor Emmanuel's permission to separate from the regular army and fight as he pleased, accompanied, as it was, with the king's remark, "Go where you like, do what you like. I feel only one regret, that I am not able to follow you." The resulting campaign showed the great guerrilla warrior at his best. As with the Neapolitans in 1849, so with the Croats in 1859, Garibaldi was credited with superhuman powers. At times, the success attending his sheer effrontery seemed almost to justify such a conclusion. Time and again he placed himself in positions so desperate that it was only his quickness of wit in seizing at a possible chance that saved him. Had he failed, he would have been rated as a bungler, but as he succeeded, the desperation of each chance served only to magnify his strategy. He was a remarkable mathematician, able to estimate all possible combinations adroitly and quickly. He never despaired, and never hesitated when he had decided on a plan. As a result, the Hunters of the Alps, or Garibaldini, as the volunteers were called, hung on the Austrian troops all through Lombardy and the Lake Country, driving them from town after town by sudden assaults, continually tricking much larger forces by clever misrepresentations of their own strength. Garibaldi entered Lombard territory and took Varese. After defeating the Austrians near there in the Battle of Malnate, he swept up to Cavallesca near Como, and, attacking a much larger force than his own, drove the enemy through Como towards Monza. Como received the Hunters with open arms. Garibaldi telegraphed to Milan using the Austrian general's name, and so gained information of the Allies. Soon afterwards, he stationed his advanced guard at the Villa Medici, looking down over lake after lake, and with a panoramic view of the Alps. Here the Austrians thought to surround him, but by means of sending false messages planned to fall into the enemy's hands, and by taking advantage of a heavy storm at night, he succeeded in escaping them and regaining Como. Meanwhile, the regular army was winning victories. Montebello, Magenta, Solferino, and San Martino were falling to the glory of French and Italian arms. The Austrians were steadily being driven back. Garibaldi left Como and took Bergamo, then Brescia. As he advanced, the men of the land he crossed joined his army. Brescia set forth to fortify its walls at his command. He was ordered to follow the Austrians, and pursued them to Treponti, which he won, although at such a cost he was obliged to fall back on the main army. Napoleon III had no intention of winning too many victories for Italy, nor of allowing the Garibaldian troops to gain unseemly power. The plans of the general were, therefore, interfered with, his recruits diverted into other channels, and the hunters sent into the passes of the Stelvio on the pretext of preventing an attack from Germany, but in reality to prevent Garibaldi from crossing Lake Garda and gaining the valley of the Adige and the Veronese mountains. The general obeyed, and conducted a markedly successful campaign near Sondrio and Bormio, finding himself in his true element among the Alps. Then came the stupefying news that Napoleon had made the peace of Villafranca. The rage of the Garibaldini knew no bounds. Their general hurried to Victor Emmanuel's camp to tender his resignation. The king would not accept it. "Italy still requires the legions you command," he said. "You must remain." Garibaldi returned to his troops, his hatred for Louis Napoleon more intense than ever, but convinced that the peace only marked a short pause in the great forward movement. Too much credit cannot be given to Victor Emmanuel for his resolution at this time. Bitterly disappointed as he must have been at such an abrupt end to a campaign that had promised to open Italy from the Alps to the Adriatic, he yet managed to hide his chagrin and held Garibaldi, even as he a little later induced Cavour to resume the post which he had, in a burst of rage, resigned. Fortunately also, the formal statement of the peacemakers that the princes should be restored to their thrones in Florence, Modena, and Parma, and the Pope's legates at Bologna, Ferrara, Forli, and Ravenna, was simply a statement. The people of those cities had quite different views. They had tasted of liberty and of the victories of a national army, and one city after another announced that it would have no more of its foreign rulers, that its people wished to become citizens of Italy and subjects of Victor Emmanuel. Garibaldi heard this and was convinced that it no longer lay in the power of his arch-enemy, Louis Napoleon, to keep Italians separated. "Whatever may be the march of existing circumstances," he said to his men, "Italians must neither lay aside their arms nor be discouraged. They ought, on the contrary, to increase in number in their ranks, to testify to Europe that, guided by their king, Victor Emmanuel, they are ready to face again the vicissitudes of war, whatever they may be. Perhaps at the moment we least expect it, the signal of alarm may again be sounded." He was sent into central Italy, and at Florence, at Bologna, at Rimini, he had only to appear to have volunteers crowd about him. Napoleon learned of this and remonstrated to the government at Turin, which attempted to check the ardor of its great general and yet keep him for further use. It was a time when Cavour's skill was taxed to the uttermost to avoid a break either with the French or with the Garibaldians. The news of Cavour's decision to cede Savoy and Nice to France, a decision only reached when it became evident that it was the price Napoleon demanded for allowing central Italy to unite with Piedmont, came like a thunderclap to Garibaldi. Born in Nice, he declared that the act made him a stranger in his own country. He was immediately returned to Parliament for Nice and bitterly attacked Cavour's policy in the chamber. He spoke at length, claiming that the cession was both an infraction of the original charter by which Nice had become a part of the Sardinian kingdom, and a violation of the fundamental law of nationality. Cavour, however, carried the Parliament with him, and Garibaldi left for Nice to take farewell of it, for he refused to remain there and become a citizen of France. He was disgusted with the compromises of diplomacy. "I have nothing to do with men or political parties," he declared. "My country, and nothing but my country, is my object." Two other incidents of the campaign of 1859 must be mentioned. The one, Garibaldi's visit to Anita's grave near Ravenna, the scene of those bitter days immediately after the fall of Rome, to which he now returned as a conqueror. The other was his marriage at Como, during his fighting in the lakes, to Giuseppina Raimondi, the adventurous daughter of the Marquis Raimondi, who persuaded the general that she was deeply in love with him, in order that marriage might shield her sadly tarnished name. Garibaldi would not hear of the marriage at first, and declared that since Anita's death his heart was withered. The Marquis answered, "It is with freedom and with Italian unity that my daughter is enamored, and with you as the embodiment of it in Italy." The general could not withstand that appeal, and consented to the marriage. The depths of the treachery were revealed to him immediately afterwards, and he left his new wife at once. It was years, however, before he was granted a divorce from her. Mazzini, Cavour, and Garibaldi each played an important part in the next act of the great drama of Italy, but Garibaldi unquestionably held the center of the stage. The act was the famous expedition of the Thousand to Sicily, a performance foolhardy and rash in the extreme, which was, however, destined to bring to a speedy fruition the long-deferred hopes of all Italian patriots. Mazzini's part was to prepare the field. He had early chosen Sicily as a most favorable scene for revolutionary action, and had sent agents to smuggle arms into the island, to hold meetings and generally to arouse the people. Cavour's part was to play the double game of protesting against the expedition in the eyes of the powers, and of aiding it as best he could secretly. He foresaw the risks that would beset it, and the even greater risk to his king, as having such a dictator as Garibaldi win many victories, yet he could not absolutely prevent a scheme devised in all patriotic fervor. He gave public orders to the Sardinian admiral to capture Garibaldi and bring him back, but with a secret message, which the admiral rightly understood as meaning that Cavour wished no such event to happen. In much the same manner, the British ambassador at Turin, Sir James Hudson, and the British fleet in the Mediterranean, although ostensibly strictly neutral, contrived not to embarrass Garibaldi, and the fleet even went so far as to appear inadvertently between the Neapolitan ships and those that bore the Thousand, thereby preventing what might have been an untimely cannonade. Though few in official places therefore openly countenanced the expedition, many hoped that it would succeed. Under such circumstances, the general sailed from Genoa on May 5, 1860, with some 1,067 picked men, many recruited from the hunters of the Alps, henceforth to be known as the Mille, and destined to make one of the greatest expeditions in history, and eventually to give two crowns to the House of Savoy. It was an historic day when the great filibuster, as Garibaldi was called, sailed from Genoa. Parents, wives, and children bade the Thousand a tearful farewell in the rocky bay of Quarto, where today a marble star upon the cliff commemorates the event. At Talamone they landed to seize some arms and to send a force of 100 men into the Papal States to incite rebellion. Then they set sail fairly out to sea, and Garibaldi and his chiefs planned the Sicilian campaign. May 11th the two shiploads reached Marsala, hotly pursued by Neapolitan cruisers. The Thousand took possession of the town. The general issued glowing proclamations to the citizens, and quickly recruited a corps of over 1,000 Sicilian scouts. From Marsala they went to Salemi, a march triumphantly acclaimed by monks, priests, women, and children who lined the roads, and with Sicilian impetuosity were carried away by the sudden appearance of an Italian army. At Salemi, Garibaldi issued this pronunciamento. Garibaldi, commander-in-chief of the national forces in Sicily, on the invitation of the principal citizens, and on the deliberation of the free communes of the island, considering that in time of war it is necessary that the civil and military power should be united in one person, assumes, in the name of Victor Emmanuel, King of Italy, the dictatorship in Sicily. The first battle was fought in the heart of the mountains at Calatafimi, where numbers of ancient ruins gave Garibaldi opportunity to use his skill in irregular fighting. The battle lasted 3 hours, Both Garibaldi's son Menotti and the son of Daniel Manin of Venice were wounded. In the end, the conflict was a victory for the Thousand. The Neapolitans fell back on Palermo, and Garibaldi planned to take the Sicilian capital. Throughout the campaign, the officers of the King of Naples showed the same sublime incompetence which characterized their sovereign. Palermo should have been easy to defend, and with this knowledge, and misled by Garibaldi's tactics into believing him in retreat, the Neapolitan general gave a great dinner at the capital and proceeded to forget the war altogether. As a result, by a remarkably swift march, Garibaldi appeared at the gates of Palermo, carried them, swept through street after street of the city, and drove the enemy into the castle and palace. For a few days the city was laid waste by bombs from the two latter positions, and from the fleet in the harbor. Then the Neapolitan general asked for an armistice, which eventually ended in the evacuation of Sicily, except at Messina and a few forts, by the army of the King of Naples. As most of the soldiers were Austrians, they left without any deep regret, in fact, with almost as much rejoicing as though they had been the victors. Free from the foreigners, Palermo gave itself up to rejoicing. Men and women donned red shirts and acclaimed Garibaldi as a second Cincinnatus in New Washington. All relics of the former rulers were destroyed. Sicily felt itself at last free to join the other states of Italy. Immediately Cavour sent agents to urge annexation to Piedmont, but Garibaldi was not yet ready for that step. He planned to win Naples and Rome before he gave over his independent dictatorship. The scene now changes to Milazzo. Thither Garibaldi's army, composed of the Thousand, of many Palermitans, of an English brigade, and of Hungarians, Frenchmen, Italians of all ranks, all drawn to the great general whose fame had now spread from end to end of Europe, proceeded. There was hard fighting at Milazzo, but in time the city fell, and Messina lay practically open to the invaders. A few more days and Garibaldi was encamped there, resting and recuperating after the entire liberation of Sicily. It is no exaggeration to say that fortune had showered her richest gifts on Garibaldi during this campaign. In a few short weeks, he had driven all the Neapolitan forces out of the island with little loss of life to his own men, had come into possession of money, arms, boats, stores of all kinds, had increased his army to some 25,000 men, had become the idol of all Sicily, to whom the red shirt became the proudest badge of man or woman, had so thoroughly frightened King Francis II that he was unwilling to join his own army of defense, and had so completely aroused Italy that from each town young and old poured forth to make their way to his invincible standard. Through it all, he, whom fortune was doing everything to spoil, remained as simple, as unmindful of personal comfort or aggrandizement as in his early days. He was at his best when he won Sicily and planned his march on Naples. It was unfortunate that the warrior should ever have attempted to become the statesman. Garibaldi's army remained at Messina for 23 days. During part of that time, the general was engaged in assuring the Sardinian government that he had no interest in a revolutionary expedition which was attempting to march into the Papal States. The rest of the time was given to perfecting his plans for a descent on Calabria. August 19th, the first detachment of the army sailed from Taormina in the Torino and the Franklin. The Neapolitan fleet was led into the belief that the embarkation would be at Messina, and by this ruse the ships succeeded in crossing to the mainland unmolested. They landed at Melito, and early the next morning Garibaldi prepared to march on Reggio. Again, speed stood him in good stead. The new Army of the South, as the Thousand with its recruits was now called, took the Neapolitan general by surprise. At 2 in the morning, Garibaldi's army marched into the city to find the garrison asleep. The Neapolitan soldiers, thoroughly alarmed at the appearance of the devil, as they named Garibaldi, so suddenly among them, paid no heed to their officers and rushed to a nearby fortress. There severe fighting occurred during the afternoon and night, but finally the stronghold capitulated, and the Garibaldians had won an important base on the mainland. He sent to Messina for the remainder of his troops, and on August 22nd began that celebrated promenade militaire from Reggio to Naples, which bore little resemblance to warfare, as the enemy fled as fast as he approached, and the countrymen, as well as deserters from the army of Naples, flocked to join his march. Matters had now come to such a pass that it was only necessary for Garibaldi to appear before a town for it to capitulate. At Villa San Giovanni, Garibaldi, with a few hundred men back of him, ordered 12,000 Neapolitans to surrender, and they immediately did so. Again, at Soveria, he ordered 1,500 of the enemy to surrender, and was obeyed. It was enough for a red shirt to appear to cause the enemy to fly or surrender. At certain parts of the march, the Neapolitan soldiers walked side by side with the Garibaldians. Town after town welcomed the great general as the liberator, as a second John the Baptist. Both natives and Austrians looked upon him with religious awe. He had only to appear to be surrounded with ecstatic multitudes. His scouts had merely to say that Garibaldi was coming to send the enemy flying in all haste. In one case, it was enough to telegraph he was near the town of Salerno. The defenders immediately decamped. The road to Naples lay open. The citizens of that easily excited capital were fairly beside themselves in eagerness to welcome the liberator. The general left Salerno by train on September 7th, but as far as speed was concerned, he might almost as well have walked. The people of all the towns on the route, Torre del Greco, Resina, Portici, turned out, covered the railroad tracks, boarded the train, climbed on the engine, shouting with joy, singing the Garibaldi hymn, frantic with enthusiasm as they hailed the man who they believed brought with him the millennium. In Naples it was the same. There was no end to the uproar, to the enthusiasm, to the adulation. Everyone wore red, everyone cheered. Even the troops of King Francis, who had retired to the castle and fortress, could not resist the enthusiasm, and flung up their caps and cheered for Garibaldi. Naples had no government. Garibaldi appointed a temporary governor and issued a proclamation glowing with patriotic fervor. People of Naples, it is with feelings of the profoundest respect and love that I present myself before you in this center of a noble and long-suffering people, whom 4 centuries of tyranny have not been able to humiliate, and whose spirit could never be broken by a ruthless despotism. The first necessity of Italy is harmony and social order, without which the unity of Italy is impossible. This day, Providence has conferred that blessing upon you and has made me its minister. The same Providence has also given you Victor Emmanuel, whom from this moment I will designate the father of our country. The model of all sovereigns, he will impress upon his posterity the duty that they owe to a people who have with so much enthusiasm chosen him for their king. You are supported by the clergy, who, conscious of their true mission, have with patriotic ardor and truly Christian conduct braved the gravest dangers of battle at the head of our Italian soldiers. The good monks of La Gancia and the noble-hearted priests of the Neapolitan continent have one and all assisted us in the good fight. I repeat that harmony is the one essential thing for Italy, and let us freely forgive those who, having disagreed with us, are now repentant, and are willing to contribute their might to build up the monument of our national glory. Lastly, we must make it apparent to all that, while we respect the houses of other people, we are determined to be masters in our own house, whether the powers of the earth like it or not. G. Garibaldi. No sooner was the need for actual warfare at an end than countless difficulties arose in the liberated city. Garibaldi was no disciplinarian. He had always entrusted all harsh measures to others. He refused to harbor suspicion or ill will. his nature was patient and simple and confiding. His sole concern was to drive the foreigners out of Italy. Beyond that, he had few plans. But as soon as Naples was free, scores of theorists in government arose. Mazzini appeared, and his followers tried to win Garibaldi over to their ideal republic. The clerical party had another plan, the secret societies still another, and the brigands who infested the country about Naples were already intriguing for the return of the Bourbons, who had allowed them free sway. Cavour sent his agents hurrying to Naples to keep the people quiet and to urge them to advocate immediate annexation with Piedmont. He had, however, a more difficult task on his hands at the same time. He feared that Garibaldi would immediately march on Rome, and Cavour knew that the papal question could not be settled in any such summary fashion. Napoleon would immediately intervene, and the army of the South would find itself fighting France. That was his great fear, and to prevent the event, if possible, he sent the army of Piedmont, of Lombardy, of Tuscany, south at the double quick. Victor Emmanuel must meet Garibaldi before the latter crossed the Volturno, if trouble with France were to be avoided. Garibaldi, however, cared very little for diplomacy. His object was to take Rome with all speed, and he refused to heed Cavour's agents. Fortunately, Francis II of Naples finally decided to make a stand, and so detained Garibaldi until the northern army could arrive. Mazzini had said to Garibaldi, "If you are not on your way towards Rome or Venice before 3 weeks are over, your initiative will be at an end." The prophecy, like so many of Mazzini's, proved true. Garibaldi had to fight several battles on the Volturno and besiege Capua before he could turn towards Rome, and by that time Victor Emmanuel had reached the scene of action. The last battles were the hardest fought of the campaign, but were ultimately won by the Army of the South. Capua held out a little longer, but finally fell, and Francis II took himself safely to Gaeta. On October 10th, Garibaldi had called for a popular vote in the two Sicilies, for or against their annexation to Piedmont. The vote was overwhelmingly for annexation. Garibaldi issued a final proclamation ending, "Italy, one, as the metropolis has wisely determined she shall be, under the king, Galantuomo, who is the symbol of our regeneration and the prosperity of our country." He met the king and handed over to him his dictatorship of the kingdom of Naples and Sicily. This moment, which was the climax of his great expedition, was the proudest of his career. The general was still eager for an immediate march on Rome, but the king would not have it. It was arranged that the army of the South should be incorporated with the royal army, and Garibaldi left Naples for Caprera. He borrowed $100 to pay certain debts, and in the same meager state in which he had set out, he returned to his rock of Caprera to wait until he should be needed. At Caprera, the general, now become the most romantic figure in Europe, received countless deputations of admirers from all nations. For a short time, he was content to resume his farm labors, but the thought of Rome loomed ever larger in his mind. He had not the gift of patience now. He was convinced that his army of volunteers could fight and overcome both France and Austria. The delays of Cavour's policy irritated him, and finally he went, in April 1861, to the Parliament at Turin to speak his mind. He made a violent attack on Cavour, to which the latter would not reply in kind. A few days later the two men met at the king's request and pretended a reconciliation. Garibaldi could not appreciate Cavour's temperate statecraft. Cavour realized that Garibaldi was becoming the most difficult problem Italy had to face. Unfortunately for Garibaldi, and doubly unfortunate for Italy, Cavour was failing in strength, and only a short time after the scene in Turin, the great minister died. If he had lived, Italy would have been spared much that followed. End of section 13.